I was going, hey, wait a minute, the world's in collapse here and we're not doing anything about it. And people were like, oh yeah, that's a problem. And there was a sense of utter disconnect in realities. Climate change is just dealt with as if it was any other discrete environmental issue. For years, we said we can solve this if everyone would just put the right light bulbs in, buy a Prius.
Liven your morning up, maybe.
What we really needed to be doing was, from the very beginning, raising hell.
All right, under arrest.
8 hours of community service, and then they'll dismiss, as if they had never been filed, the charges. In theory, I could just show up and do this every 2 weeks or so if I wanted.
Woke up at 2:30 in the morning thinking, why am I doing this? Nobody's gonna care, nobody's gonna notice.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5 postcard boots.
If you've done all the legal available methods and they don't work, then the only thing that you have left is to put your body in the way.
I feel a large amount of pride for stuff my dad does, because save the world and all that.
The odds are vanishingly small, but that's no excuse for not figuring out what to do next, so.
One man can't do this.
He's speaking to
him. Life is hard for zealots. Some of my heroes in history were zealots, the suffragettes, the abolitionists.
Makes him hard to love, but it also makes him worth loving, I guess.
He's dedicated, he's articulate, he's passionate, and he's guilty.
And now showing Exhibit 18 to the jury.
We need moral clarity, we need sides to be drawn. Either you're for burning fossil fuels and ending the world, or you're against it. Which is it?
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to a conversation with Ken Ward. He's this guy right here, and he's the guy who was in the documentary trailer we just watched. I'm very excited to talk to you. Thank you for joining us, Ken.
I'm really glad to be here, John.
Yeah. And Laura is with us, and Marcus is with us. Yes, he woke up very early in Germany to join this conversation because we have a real-life climate hero with us. Thank you, guys. Thank you, all of you. And wow, 18 of you in the audience already. Good to see you here. We will be taking your questions. I've got a bunch for Ken, and I was going to load them into the chat, and I failed. But we'll be going through them and just talking about this amazing accomplishment that happened. If you guys don't know, back in 2016, while we were broadcasting Bernie, Ken and four other revolutionaries were shutting down the Kinder Morgan pipeline that brings 15% of the oil into the United States. So, Ken, let's talk about that. We were in Green Room, and you mentioned that it was really weird to see yourself in a documentary. Weird is my word, but you were like, you get to watch these 2 years of your life kind of encapsulated. How did that journey begin with Lindsey Grayzel?
It is strange, especially if you're sitting through screenings of the movie regularly. First couple times I saw the movie, I was just obsessed with how I looked. Like, oh, geez, my hair, you know, does my hair look good on that one? Yeah. It's very hard to pay attention to the whole movie. It took a while, so I was like, okay, I can understand what Lindsey's narrative arc was. And I can now use words, phrases like narrative arc with right. some confidence.
Right.
Lindsey was just a friend of mine. I was a documentary filmmaker who lives in Portland who happened to care about climate change as an individual, had never done anything on it. We talked a little bit about climate change, and he thought some of the things I had to say were interesting and asked me if she could follow me around for a month or do a couple of interviews. And her intention was to create a 5 or 10 minute long YouTube video and just put it up, and the whole thing would, as I said, take about a couple months. So I agreed to that, and then sometime in those 2 months, I started working on one next action that I was interested in, and she asked if she could follow me in doing that, and then that led to the next one. And before we knew it, it had been 2 years and two different trials. She had been arrested and charged with sabotage in the state of Washington, and it was quite a long journey for Lindsey.
Yeah, because that's, I mean, we were talking about being afraid of getting arrested. You mentioned it in the shot I showed. I want to show everybody this because you said it was the best comic line of the documentary. This is, I don't know if everybody, you have to watch the movie, everybody. The ReluctantRadicalMovie.com, go there, and there's many ways to download, and we'll be doing a screening of it in September. But if you look in this picture, this is where Ken's being arrested, protesting an ExxonMobil, and the sign there, if you see the sign on the ground, that cop is actually, he put that sign very nicely upright. It had fallen down, and I thought that was really funny. But you said something that really surprised me about being arrested and your fear. What was that?
I'm not sure I remember.
You said that your fear was gone when the handcuffs went.
Oh, yeah. No, that was the case. I had done a fair amount of actions, including the lobster boat blockade, where we were on a 33-foot boat for about 5 hours with law enforcement from U.S. Coast Guard and the State Police dive unit and a variety of others, and never ended up getting arrested. So having just literally gotten this far in life without being engaged in a direct action, I'd never been arrested. And so I just found it scary. So eventually I decided I just needed to practice, which is what the Exxon station was. I did that because Bill McKibben came out with this, I think it was the Rolling Stone article about that Exxon knew, that kind of walked through how long Exxon has known what the climate change impacts from its sales would be.
Yeah.
And then he emphasized it by going out and standing in front of a gas pump till he was arrested somewhere in Burlington, Vermont. Huh. And he called on other people to do the same thing. So I decided, okay, I'll go do that. Went out and stood, found that there's only two Exxon or Mobil pumps and Portland, Oregon. So I stood in front of one of them, and eventually they came and politely asked me to leave, and I said no, and then they arrested me. And then, as I said earlier, the minute that the handcuffs were put on, that fear kind of evaporated. Something about once you're in the situation and there's nothing you can do about it, then your body or your brain just decides, well, that's a useless fear. The point of that fear is to get me to run away, right? It's sure. Too late now.
Sure, right. So. And so since then, have you been arrested since the Exxon?
Well, I was arrested for the shut it down action, and which you discussed at the beginning, where we shut down all five pipelines running Canadian tar sands oil into the U.S. on one day. And then I was arrested twice this last in April. On Earth Day, it's been a desire. It's been a goal of mine to be arrested on Earth Day for quite some time. So that was thrilling. Where we built a garden on railroad tracks going into the Zenith Energy facility in Portland, which is currently ramping up its export of Canadian tar sands. It's quadrupling, as far as we know. It's quadrupling its export in a city which is on record as opposing any increase in fossil fuel infrastructure. So they were rebuilding the yard, building new fossil fuel infrastructure, and the city is incapable of doing anything about it. So in two consecutive Sundays, we shut it down by building a garden on the railroad tracks, and that was a lot of fun and also involved some being arrested.
Well, and I watched that. I saw that. There was a live broadcast on that when that happened, and we were broadcasting that day as well, and I remember seeing that. So thank you for that. That's a really, I love that. It obviously drew attention, and it's a smart thing to do.
Yeah, it really did. You know. Something about the garden, it sort of takes some of the rough edges off the direct action part. People loved it.
If you can see that, I got a couple shots of that. There's you, just kind of kicking it back with the garden in the background.
Yeah, we had a little tiny house and some garden implements, and I brought that chair. I didn't get that back, unfortunately. I got to wear my overalls for gardening and a straw hat that's very much like my grandfather, he was a popcorn farmer in Southern Illinois, and he wore a hat like that. So I wear that hat in tribute for him.
That's very cool. That's very cool. Do you farm now? Do you till land, or you get?
I have just moved into my sweetheart's house in Yamhill, and she's got a few acres here, and we are planning next year's garden as we speak.
I asked this for more reasons down the road. I say this because in the documentary, there's a scene at the beginning where you're using a sickle cutting your yard. I don't even know because I use a lawnmower. I have a 1 acre orchard packed with fruit trees. And I was going to ask you, do you do that? Did you like do your whole acreage that way? Because that's like really impressive.
Yes. So here's how that happened. I mean, I was doing it anyway, and that's actually my other grandfather's size. So that's kind of fun.
That is cool.
I was flying back and forth after I moved out here 5 years ago. I was flying back and forth to Boston to get ready to go to trial on the lobster boat blockade. And I was concerned about the carbon, my carbon use. So I thought, well, I'll look into carbon offsets. Which I did enough to realize that it's a complete scam. Almost all of them that are available to individuals are.
Uh-oh.
Oh, we
lost Ken. Froze. And we lost Ken. All right, everybody.
Here he is again.
There we go. We lost you for a second.
All right. I don't know what happened there, yeah.
That's all right. We'll get you back.
Anyway, I decided to create my own carbon offsets program. So to do that, you have to find a thing that would reduce carbon emissions that would not otherwise happen unless someone pays you money to do so for the carbon offset. So I decided, well, I'm going to stop using a gas mower on my lawn, which I had full intention of doing, and I'll start cutting it by hand. And as long as somebody pays me, I'll continue to do that. So that was like the first step. And I calculated that I could start selling carbon offsets after I had already offset my flights back and forth to Boston. So that's 2 years worth of cutting. And then you have to have it independently verified, right? So I asked my mom when we talked once a week, I said, all the questions you usually ask, like, is Eli getting enough food? You know, brushing his teeth, my son. He said, can you just add a little question that says, and are you continuing to cut your lawn using a scythe and not a gas mower? And then that would count as independent verification. So she agreed to do that. And I said, of course, you'll probably die before we'll get to the end of all the offsets. So you have to find somebody else who will fulfill that role for you 20 years out. Anyway, if you actually do your own homegrown carbon offset program, it shows the idiocy or the unreality of the large scale ones.
Mate, that's good to know. Hang on a second. We keep having a problem here with the camera, and I gotta fix this here. I think we dropped out for a second. There we go. Thank you, Zoom. And I'm shiny. My head was not supposed to be this shiny. That's, I'm sorry. I was listening at the same time. I was trying to fix a technical error and thinking I was being all cool with it.
Multitasking.
Thank you. Trying to make it look like I was listening all the way, but I really was. And that's like a great way to find out how useless that is. And I was going to talk about that because we'll get it. Might as well just jump there. I want to talk about the whole legal adventure of what happened with the five, you know, the big valve turner event, but because there's been some updates on that, the necessity being able to, you know, the climate necessity defense. But let's just skip to for Oregonians. Let's just jump to cap and trade and HB 2020 real quick and talk about that climate bill, right? Which was the only thing we had going in Oregon, and it was a cap and trade, and it caused a militia to come out and Republicans to run away, and really caused some problems. What do you think of HB 2020 and you know, is it even worth fighting for?
Yeah, the whole circus has been astounding. And a large part of it being that we could provoke such a reaction for such an innocuous piece of legislation. I've been opposed to cap and trade as a concept for 15 years or so. I don't find anything about the Oregon bill that's much different than any of the other proposed pieces. It's sort of fundamentally flawed, I think. It is useful to kind of keep in mind, or for people who don't know this, the history of a cap and trade. It has some assumptions built into it that were part of the climate strategy of U.S. environmentalists working with Enron quite some time ago. So the original idea, which was concocted by Enron and NRDC, the two main players here, right, and then supported by some key foundations, including the Pew Trusts. The original idea was to put in place a framework that would have almost no impact initially, but would over time, you'd be able to sort of ratchet it down over time. But the time frame we're talking about here, I mean, back then, was hundreds of years. I mean, that's how much time we thought we had to undertake significant success. And part of the thinking was, well, if you look at the polls and focus groups, if you talk to people about what's really happening or what the real threat of climate change is, they get depressed or they block it out. And so at the time, NRDC, you know, giving them the most positive credit possible, was trying to figure out a way to, how do you actually put in place policy without going to, without engaging in a big public fight? And cap and trade was partly that solution. They thought we would have, you know, significant Enron level corporate support. That we could pass a policy without there being a public fight around it, that it would have support within both major parties.
Right.
So and that we'd have hundreds of years after it was put in place to ratchet it up. So none of those things have played out. None of them.
None.
and we're still trying to pass a bill that is, you know, essentially antique science built into it.
Yeah.
So if you didn't agree with any of those assumptions, which I didn't, I never thought we were going to get, industry was never going to support anything. They're going to fight to the last minute. I never thought we would be able to put anything in place unless we entered into and then won a vigorous public campaign. You know, public, this had to be a public fight at the level of ending slavery. Seemed obvious that we should prepare for that. And that nothing within current, nothing that we could pass within current political constraints, and this is even 15 years ago, would come anywhere close to touching the scale of change that's necessary to address climate change.
Right.
So it's much more useful to think about policy and policy debates within what can be conceived within current politics, that the use of that is primarily to help define what the problem is. And so if you're putting out things like cap and trade that are presented as solutions that don't cause major change or don't require major changes in society, that don't come anywhere close to touching the scale of a problem, then you're lying. I mean, it's a lie. And that, you know, doesn't actually advance a true functional solution. And it's hugely dispiriting to the relatively small percentage of people who actually are the ones who are fighting to try to achieve change.
Right.
So I think being honest and clear with people who are paying attention is a fundamental that should never be violated. And anyone that's trying to do that, and essentially if you're trying to vote for or support something like cap and trade, you have to lie. It, maybe to yourself, but at least in public, you have to, you know, pretend like it's a success. It's a functional solution when it's not.
I mean, if you're awake to the understanding that incremental things, especially something like that, is just aren't going to cut it, then what's the point? It seems like it's proved its own failure.
If we're going to lose, it's much better to lose advancing functional solutions that help illuminate the scale of the problem and the scale of change that's necessary, because we're going to keep losing. We're not in a position to advance functional solutions. So, but because climate impacts will keep getting worse, that's the driver of the political change, not, incremental success at convincing people to drop capitalism and stop, drop fossil fuels. That's just, we're going to do it because we have to, not because we want to.
Right, but it's after enough damage has incurred to industries and individuals that have the means to make it happen, right? Is that what we're saying, really, to make the ball start rolling?
So. I always thought that the only way this is going to, you know, our shot here at getting a future we would really want to live in is going to occur only in extremis, right, at the last minute.
We do that.
Not going to voluntarily. The other side, there's too many people that don't want to think about it at all, and there's too much money.
Right.
On the other side. So the only way, we're going to reach some point of crisis, and yeah, I thought that was 100 years ago. It's not. It's going to be much closer than that. But we're going to, and at that point, we know what the other side is going to propose, which is a bunch of extreme physical measures like sulfur in the upper atmosphere and a billion mile our balloons in geosynchronous orbit and iron filings dropped into the ocean. That's what's going to be the proposal.
Yep.
In order to keep burning the fossil fuels and the other stuff we're doing as well. And so we need to have a pretty clear idea of what the alternative looks like, which will be drastic in its own right, but we should be proposing those now.
Right.
So that there are 10 or 20 years or whatever it is of us saying, this is what the future looks like. It will be harsh. But it will also bring us in a direction where we actually want to live.
Right.
It's kind of the joy of the stuff we've done around Zenith, which we're not engaging in the day-to-day politics of what's happening in Portland very much. We're just saying, hey, you know, the city says it can't close down this oil export plant because it doesn't have the technical means for doing it. And we've replied by saying, oh, yes, you do. You could simply rezone the entire area from industrial, which is what it is now, to open space. And if we did that and a few other serious measures like that, we would end up with a city that's much, much more beautiful, much more livable, much more a place we want to be.
Right.
If we use our city to grow food rather than importing it, we reduce our impact overall. If we get rid of cars in downtown, it's a whole set of things you could do that would just, we'd end up in a place we'd really like to be living.
None of the people in power want this, and none of the corporations that it would affect want this, and that's where it comes to the problem. And I don't want to take that with this, because you made a comment about this on Facebook, and I just want to push this. So this is the Guardian article about philanthropists vow to raise millions for climate activists, and that apparently is Extinction Rebellion. And you made a comment here, 20 years too late, but we'll take it. Though why Bill McKibben, friend that he is, should be sitting on panel handing out dollars to Extinction Rebellion U.S. chapters and school strike groups is beyond me. Is this good? Is this bad? Is this just, I guess the real question I want to ask here is do we have to use capital? Are we going to be able to save the human species with capitalism, or are they kind of mutually exclusive?
Oh, I think they're mutually exclusive. I mean, capitalism is based on expropriating resources without really paying for them and without in any way taking on a whole set of costs, and it's based on rapacious growth. None of those things are continuable. I do think we need to recognize that it's not merely capitalism. That's the challenge here. We're facing stuff that's just part of, you know, every culture's understanding about the good sides, the upsides and the downsides of being human. The desire to own pretty stuff is not limited to capitalism, but other societies have done a better job of regulating that desire. I mean, we're living in the Pacific Northwest, which is the home of potlatch, right? Where the richest people in the society once a year had to just give away their stuff, which is a marvelous way of keeping things from escalating. But those kind of basic challenges of dealing with sins and virtues are we have to get to. And I think there's a lot of history in our spiritual traditions that we can turn to, but we're in a point of crisis where the sins are losing or winning. And I think that goes beyond just dismantling capitalism.
All right. Well, yeah, I agree. I think we've got to get rid of capitalism, though, to like continue as a civilization. But it looks like we have to use the mechanism to accomplish that, which it's like politics. We got to elect Bernie with money and then get rid of money. Right. Basically, I want to bounce back talking about that and just methods that are like what's actually going to be effectual if the laws that they're pushing are just basically distractions in the current with, you know, the Oregon government federally. It's a you are doing direct actions which put you in the legal system, which get a lot of media attention, which generate a lot of attention in general. The large event, which the valve turner event in 2016, was unprecedented. And please, you know, I was trying to follow what happened. I've got a piece here from April 29th of this year, and it says that judge rules valve turner Ken Ward must be allowed to present necessity defense for climate action. And talk about this. What does this mean? And what does this mean for legal climate battles moving forward?
Well, the necessity defense is just common law from within the Anglo-Saxon tradition, but it's really just common sense, which is if you're charged with a crime, you know, you should be able, but you did it for the purpose of trying to avoid some greater harm, then it just kind of makes sense that you should be able to say that somewhere in the process. At least preferably you wouldn't be charged at all, but if you are. So the classic example is that if you're walking down the street and you see a house on fire and you see a kid in the house and you break in to get the kid out before the house burns down, and then you get charged with breaking and entering or trespass, you should be able to tell a jury that, yeah, I did do that, but it was for this greater purpose. So that's a widely understood part of the law that is sometimes successfully used in political cases. And our challenge has been to see if we can advance a climate necessity defense in cases like the valve turning action. So we asserted it in each of the four jurisdictions where our folks were charged. It was denied in three of them, including mine. It was allowed in Minnesota, where two of our members were actually let off by the judge who said that the prosecution hadn't proved their case.
Oh.
And then in my case, after I faced two charges, one of sabotage and the other of burglary in Skagit County in Washington. And in the first trial, I got a hung jury on both counts, which is a surprise.
Yeah,
and
that's
in the
rare.
Second trial, I got a hung jury on the charge of sabotage and was convicted on the charge of burglary. So I appealed on the basis that I wasn't allowed to present a necessity defense, climate necessity defense, which is the only defense I had. And the appeals panel of three judges unanimously agreed in a very powerfully written decision that said, agreed with us that my federal, my constitutional right to free and fair trial had been abridged, and these overturned my conviction and returned it to Skagit County to try me again if they choose.
Okay.
That decision has now been appealed by Skagit County, both to the full appeals court in Washington and also to the Washington Supreme Court. So we're waiting to see what happens. If the panel, and it's rare that a unanimous panel is overturned. So they've got a tough row to hoe there. So if they don't get it overturned, then it's back in Skagit County's hands. I could conceivably go back to Skagit County a third time for a trial, but this time it would be with allowed a climate necessity defense. And that means that my argument that we are in a situation where no legally available means available to me, to address climate change, taking the action that I took would be effective, or at least I would think it would be effective. And part of the answer to that is the belief that engaging in direct action like that helps mobilize political pressure to change the legal situation. So I would be allowed to put experts on the stand, and we were ready to put Dr. James Hansen and Bill McKibben and other experts on climate change and on the political process on the stand to testify to all these things. And it would allow my lawyers to argue to the jury that they can, as a matter of law, find me not guilty on the basis of the testimony that they heard. So that would be pretty powerful. Yeah. It would be a great event, and they might well just choose not to try me again to avoid.
Yeah, you know, that's bad optics for Skagit County there, you know, or it could be if they want to double down on that. So, that's, I mean,
and then
that's,
you also asked the impact on others. It's a, then it would stand as a ruling. It would directly impact anybody charged who wants to offer a climate necessity defense in Washington. It would be standing, you know, precedent. Right. And then it can, because it can be cited in other jurisdictions, it would be a powerful supporting legal precedent for other people wanting to advance climate necessity defense.
Right. I mean, that's huge. And it seems like we're having more success with climate in the legal realm than we are anywhere else. I mean, it's just kind of weird, you know?
Well, it's the only branch of government at the moment where truth matters, right? I mean, you can't just go in and flat out lie in court in the same way that you can if you happen to be president or member of state legislature, or, you know, like there's actual procedures for determining what's true and what's a lie.
Yeah.
If I was to go to trial on a climate necessity defense and I put Jim Hansen on the stand and other climate scientists to say this is the state of things, Skagit County would be unable to find any other climate scientist, credible climate scientist, that could be put on the stand. And if they did, they'd be gutted.
Right.
I mean, if they did find a climate denier to go on the stand, because the stuff that they can get away with when they're in media for, or, you know, in the general stuff, they just couldn't do. There's just a nice little system of evidence.
Right. It's sad that we are using our courts in a way like a stage and broadcast for what we should have done years ago on mainstream media that they refused to do. Right, which was hold an open and honest discussion about the climate crisis.
Yeah. This is why the Children's Trust cases, the atmosphere trust cases, are really helpful. Aside from being a lever for, you know, potentially achieving change, they're also tremendously effective ways to present the reality, the science, the potential impacts, and the victims of climate change. They're tremendously powerful lawsuits in that sense.
It's too bad we can't force Congress to go to these hearings. They certainly don't want to listen to the information when they're sitting in session, you know. Laura, I see a bunch of questions popping up in chat, but I haven't been able to keep track of them.
I keep raising my hand.
Oh, my bad. Let's hit them.
That's okay.
Great.
Well, the main one that I saw is Sharon Abro asks, when will the judge decide that the defendants have exhausted enough other means of trying to bring the needed change?
I'm not sure I understand the question entirely. If it's
me either.
I mean, in my case, that was just decided. That was the essence of what the appeals court decided in Washington. Let me take a step back. What we had argued to the judge is that if I was allowed to present my evidence and my experts, that I would be able to demonstrate that there are no legally available means by which someone like me, who's been working on climate change for 20 years, can address it. There aren't any.
Yeah.
And therefore, I have a basis to engage in direct action.
Yeah.
The appeals, I was denied that by the judge because the judge said I wouldn't be able to prove that. The appeals court said, no, there's credible evidence, especially in this guy's case, because I did literally work on climate change. I mean, I've been a professional environmental advocate since I was 20 something. So I've been working on this for a very long time, and I personally worked on pretty much every avenue that you can think of on climate change and could testify to that. That's not a requirement of the necessity defense. You don't have to have done it yourself. Mm-hmm. But it makes for a powerful story.
Sure.
So what the judges said is there's plenty of evidence that this guy could meet that standard. So you should have allowed him to offer the defense. And then it's up to the jury to decide whether or not he meets the standard.
Mm-hmm. There you go. Thank you. Good. And that makes sense. It makes sense. What was the other question, Laura?
That was the only question that I had noted. Oh, wait, but Sharon asked again. So if the necessity defense was allowed by the appeals court, that is a great success.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
No, I think she asked the question earlier up in the stream. I think that you punched that button right after she asked it and thought you were psychic. That was the only question that I noted, though, John. Did you see something else?
Might not have been. I was just cruising through.
Good conversation with you guys, though. Really, we have 28 watching and having a great focused conversation. So that's appreciated. Thanks, guys.
Yeah. Well, Ken's good to listen to. I don't have to do much talking. So we've got some other things to talk about here. We're going to get into some deeper stuff because I did have quite a question list, and we're at 40 minutes, like 35 actually, because we started 5 minutes late. But I want to ask you. We're going to talk about despair because you mentioned it before. For those of you who have not seen this documentary, please. TheReluctantRadicalMovie.com. Go there. We will be doing a screening on this channel with Ken and the producer, Lindsey Grayzel, but that's not till September. I urge you to go rent it or buy it from that website. You can link to a bunch of places to see it. It gets really personal with you, Ken. I mean, that's some pretty... we're really looking into your life a lot there. And the reason I was so excited about being able to talk to you didn't really hit me until I watched the movie, and it's because you deal with despair. You dealt with despair. You were freaking out about climate before other people were, and you were in a relationship, and there was this disconnect there, right? And when it was like, hey, let me tell you how bad things are, the reaction was, the kind of reaction I got recently, which everybody who knows me who watched this program knows that I was basically told, wow, you need to seek therapy. You're a little crazy. Back off, honey. It's not that bad. Talk about the disconnect between people who really are panicking and those who are buffering, and how you deal with the despair, the frustration of the crisis.
And it's much more pertinent now than when I was first going through this because there's so many more people. I mean, there's a hefty volume of articles of talking about, I think just in the last week, I read one article that was interviews of how climate scientists themselves are dealing with that disconnect. Another article I was reading today about how psychiatrists and psychologists are being swamped with people coming in. It's a particularly odd form of dislocation. If you delve into it enough to understand that or as Jim Hansen puts it, that the conditions that make civilization itself possible are threatened in the very short term. And then you just continue to live life where you're surrounded by a whole society and family and friends that just, I mean, even if they say that they agree that, oh yeah, climate change is a problem, very few of them it doesn't affect people's lives.
Right.
And so they, or any more than any other issue that people might care about. So whereas for some of us, the alarm bells have gone off to say, oh no, this means we have to stop doing what we're doing. We have to stop doing what we're doing. We're in an emergency. We have to address this for our kids or however you want to think about it.
Right.
And other people aren't. And it comes up in odd ways. For me, I get really pissed at PBS radio, OPB radio, for some reason. That particularly annoys me because I'm driving along and I listen to OPB, and there'll be news, climate change, a little climate change thing, and then back to news, which includes the basic idea that business you know, like growth matters, business growth. The only thing, the only way to determine whether a policy is good is how many jobs does it bring in, or right. how much taxes. There's no change in the fundamental assumptions of how we understand what's good about the society.
Right.
And then every once in a while go, oh yeah, and by the way, we're driving off a cliff.
Yes.
So
yes.
it does leave you in a, it's a powerful incentive to buffer yourself.
Yeah.
You know, and most people do that without thinking about it, but some people actually do it consciously. It's just much easier to just not think about it or pretend that somehow it will be solved. But if you can't do that, if you're or won't do that, then yeah, you're put in this difficult situation of trying to figure out how to live with other people who don't agree with that, that just aren't going along with it.
Right.
And I find most people, or lots of people, end up, or some people, I have not enumerated this, but, you know, families tear over this.
Yeah.
Marriages break up, you know, kids become separated from their parents. It's quite devastating.
Yeah. And I think, you know, Dar Jamal, the article that I shared with you before this show, just kind of talking about what we're going to go over, and he talks about Joanna Macy and her statement on, you know, we have to face the pain, and that we're not, you know, that's a lot of pain to face the fact that we've caused the extinction of many species and probably ourselves. And, you know, we have to face that, and you and I have to go. And even if we fail, we're supposed to buck up and feel responsible and do what we're supposed to do. And that's a lot, even for the people that are like morally, yep, I'm there, I'm ready, but still, you know, there are,
well, it's worth noting that there are certainly a set of people who this isn't new to. So if you've been an environmentalist, this has been true all along.
Yeah.
It hasn't been quite as visceral or as immediate.
Right.
But, you know, I mean, this it's just the same thing we've been dealing with all along. And, you know, in terms of what you do, I don't actually know. I do know that, I don't know if it's a matter of choice or a matter of personality and brain chemistry, or there's certainly some people who just, it's not really an option once you know the situation to do anything different.
Right.
I mean, it's not possible to go back to pretending you don't understand it.
Right.
Or the red pill, black pill thing of,
yes.
I actually tried. I mean, there's been a couple times when I just tried to go get another kind of a job and just function, and it just, I couldn't do it. So I eventually ended up just deciding whatever the impacts were, which for me had been primarily just unemployment.
Right.
I've been unemployable in my chosen profession for 20 years now. It's still the case that people who think like I do or are taking the kind of approaches that I do are just not employable. There's no jobs for us, which is kind of weird if you think about it. We're like $1 trillion economy, right? And there's like literally no way that out of 20 years, I got an AmeriCorps stipend for two of them. I think one way that we'll know that there's been any kind of significant change going on is that there will be at least sort of minimal support provided for people like me that are trying to do this as a full-time job. But it doesn't matter. I'm happier doing this without pay and without any real successes to point to. That's a happier situation than trying to pretend that it's not happening.
Wow. That says a lot. And you've had a lot of successes. So, I mean, that's, you know, where you've had a lot of individual successes, individual wins and battles. We haven't, you know, the war is still lost, but
yeah, we're not doing anything that's affected anything yet. So
right.
It's pretty, To the extent that there, I mean, one of those sort of sub debates that's out there is, you know, how much do we need to offer people hope?
Right.
And I think the answer to that is pretty easy. We should offer no hope, because there is right now there is no hope available to us that we can see, and it's better not to lie. right? I mean, that's what is to me is the fundamentals. But there is this argument that we kind of have to offer people hope, and that tends towards kind of what the major environmental organizations all do, which is to pick small things, win one or two of those, and then trumpet that as a victory. So I think that's awful, and we shouldn't be doing that. And so I can say nothing that I have done, however apparently successful, has had one whit of impact. It's been an utterly hopeless failure, and yet it's important to keep doing it. And many of us would keep doing this even if we were guaranteed that there would be no result, because it's a better way to live. Because some of us believe that it's important that some humans just try to do the right thing, even if we fail, for who knows what reason. Some future somebody looking at us would go, at least some people tried. I mean,
that's what hope is. That's what hope is. You redefine it to that, right? Because we're not going to get the hope of Star Wars. We're going to get the hope of, you know, you're doing what's right. Just be proud of that, buddy.
Yeah, I'm not sure I agree with you. I've been working on a paper that I haven't quite finished that says we should, you know, that whether or not we have hope is not the right question. The question is whether we have courage.
Right. Yeah.
And I'm not sure I like that, because I think it's possible to do this without much courage. So I don't want to go far too far down that road.
Can I be something courageous and still be scared to death? Because that's me.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's...
I'm scared to death, like, you know, and I think when you were talking about the levels of panic, and in the documentary, you know, you were panicking 20 years ago, and 20 years ago, most of us weren't even awake politically. You know, there's been this big revolution that's happened in the last 4 years, thanks to this old white guy. And, you know, the climate crisis, I remember when Al Gore, I remember, you know, Inconvenient Truth, and then I remember everything went away. I think one of the struggles that we have, and I want to bring this up because this is the best freaking quote out of your, I love this quote, and I'd never seen this before. This is, for those of us that are awake, to me, this is the hardest part. And maybe this is why other people buffer, okay? I arise in the morning torn between a desire to improve or save the world and a desire to enjoy or savor the world. This makes it hard to plan the day. E.B. White, I spend hours. Do I drive my car? Do I not drive my car? Do I do this? Do I not? Do I do more videos? You know, this is the, what do I do that's the most effective, but also, you and I are human beings, and at some point we have to stop and look at the, you know, how much savoring do we do in between saving, right?
Yeah. Emily Johnson, one of the alternatives, is quoted, uses that quote. And it's great to have a poet around, by the way, because they just come out with these things every once in a while.
Yeah.
You're getting your action. Emily does that. So, but I think that struggle that you just described is itself the thing that gives life. You know, it's like each of us have to make our own calls. We're constantly being criticized for not doing one or the other right. I mean, actually, few people criticize me too much, but sometimes they ask questions with pointed edges to them. And, you know, there'll be the people who believe strongly that the most important thing that you should do is to live right life correctly, right? Reduce your own carbon footprint. And so they'll ask me why I'm driving a Jeep in the movie, or why I'm buying cheeseburger for my son, that kind of thing. And there'll be other people that will be towards the other end of, why aren't you doing more? Why didn't you do some more of this? And, who probably couldn't care if I'm, you know, flying around. So the struggle to figure out where you are on that scale of how you balance those things, is a great question to have. And it's difficult, but I think it's a better, I'm not sure what's going on in the minds of people who are, I kind of get how you can be in full denial. It's just a conspiracy. These awful people have, you know, like, that's easy for me to understand. But people who are in the middle, but people like my friends, many of my friends who are still working for professional environmental organizations that get up and go spend their day, you know, working on ineffectual things. I have a difficult time understanding how you do that, because they aren't struggling with that question of how do I do the most effective thing here?
Right.
What matters?
Just, right. Right.
And I don't know if it's occurring at some subconscious level, or, you know, I, don't know.
I think it's a way, I personally, I think you can do that job and you can container that job and completely separate it from the reality of the crisis. I think that's, we've just got that down as a species, you know.
Yeah.
Why, just, we're running out of time here, but I want to hit, like, why XR? You're a member of Extinction Rebellion, and I meant to ask, like, did you actually have a title with Extinction Rebellion? Because I don't know what the infrastructure is there. But, you know, what do you find that to be direct action and Extinction Rebellion to be the most effective thing you could be doing right now personally?
Well, I mean, I'm a supporter of Extinction Rebellion, is the role. And I was one of the people who worked on the Zenith. We also, by the way, had 300 people in downtown Portland not too long ago and shut down the street in front of City Hall.
Awesome.
For a day, which is more along the lines of what XR has done in the UK. And the reason, I mean, what Extinction Rebellion is offering us in the form of what's happened in the UK is the single most politically effective approach to climate that anyone has found anywhere in the world. I mean, in a relatively short period of time, they put enough people on the streets of London and other major cities in the UK to be disruptive enough economically and politically to force climate change from being a third or fourth tier issue in the UK to right below Brexit in less than a year. Nobody has come anywhere close to doing anything like that. And that being the case, it seems to me that we ought to, you know, instantly, as we are around the world, trying to replicate that effectiveness in other places by adapting the UK approaches, you know, to our own situation. And that's what we're trying to do.
Right. Just got to be a little more careful, I would think, with the police here. And haven't there been a lot of laws passed, the kind of thing you did with the Kinder Morgan action you can't really get away with anymore, right?
There have been laws at the state level to strengthen the actions like we did on pipelines, but and there's the federal government just proposed some new language at the federal level.
Right.
But there have always been those laws. I mean, we could have been charged under the Patriot Act,
right,
for example. I don't think that's going to have a big effect. I think that it will have, or potentially has, the effect of putting more people in prison for longer periods of time when we get to that point, which isn't too far off. But, you know, things are... The way I look at that is that we had a brief window of opportunity to address this problem, or to try to address this problem through available legal civic means, and that's long past. Now we're in the period where we have a brief, even briefer period, where we might be able to address this using nonviolent actions. After that, you know, is revolution and violence. That's the only thing that, I mean, that when we get to the point when people are dying in large numbers, that's the response that people are going to take. And so we need to use this last opportunity for nonviolent change. I think it's important for people to understand we have a limited period of time to engage in nonviolent change. And that's why people need to step up, because, you know, after that, you really are into just giving up and despair, which is what large numbers of people are doing right now, and is not particularly helpful, or other means of change, which we really don't want to be doing.
Right. Right. Well, I mean, it does seem that we have a rather large climate crisis. And then on top of that, we were added a fascist problem that we just, like, dang. Yeah. And, you know, we kind of have to get rid of one to fix the other. And it's just quite a mess. But this has been an amazing conversation. I am looking forward to having you back in September. Are you able to tell us anything about upcoming actions that XR or you have going on? Or, you know, let me put it this way. I was going to talk to you about direct action being the best way for everyone. And you know, I signed up for XR, but said I won't go to jail. I can't do it. So I don't know exactly what I would do.
Yeah,
for XR.
That's great. In order to engage in direct action or even mass actions like on the streets, there are large numbers of people that need to support the people who are willing to take, you know, who are taking the risk.
Right.
So
right.
That's the simplest answer. There's lots of roles for people to play. Everyone can choose exactly what level of risk they are able or willing to take. But there's lots of roles that don't have any risk at all. So if you can't do the things that we know are effective directly, then do them indirectly and support people who are.
There you go. There you go. Like broadcasting and stuff. Ken, this has been amazing. Laura, Marcus, are there any other questions? We'll hit audience first. Any questions in the chat? No.
Nope. Okay. No, it's been a great conversation, though. What a nice group. It was. Thank you for being here. If you're watching, if y'all are watching this movie later, you can see the comments if you activate them. It's been a great conversation.
And my general question was already discussed about capitalism. And the only thing I wanted to add is, that I'm very skeptic that the time that we have got enough time, you know, to create a complete new mindset. You know, this would be needed. You know, in my opinion. And but we cannot stop. We got to go on. We got to do what we can.
I agree with that.
I guess that's what it comes down to. You got to have hope in something, and so we just keep doing. And So that's not depressing, everyone. That's just we're in the most exciting sci-fi horror adventure film of our lifetimes right now, and we have real climate action heroes like Ken Ward to kind of lead the way in direct action. Ken, thank you so much. We will be talking to you soon because we're going to have you back on to do. We're going to run the movie, and hopefully you and Lindsey will join us to talk about a little bit more of the details inside that. And
I look forward to it. And this was fun. And that's one of the things we have to do is have some fun while we're also being truthful.
That's true.
Absolutely. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much. A little savor. Ken Ward, everybody, The Reluctant Radical, please go watch or download the movie, rent the movie, buy the movie. You can get it in a number of different places. If you go to the website, thereluctantradicalmovie.com, they've got all these ways. You know, iTunes, Amazon, Google Play, order the DVD. If you're in educational school or library, PBS, there's actually a listing of all the places it's going to be shown upcoming. And then we're going to host a screening. We're going to host a screening in Lake Oswego, Oregon. We're going to host a screening on Uphill Media. So join us for that. Support this because, you know, this wasn't put to, I don't think you guys got any money from Exxon to do this project, did you? No.
Didn't think so.
No, this has been awesome, everybody. We're going to get out of here with, the life video because that's life on Earth. This is what we're dealing with right now. And you all know how I feel about this. We've been doing this for a while and, we started this for Bernie, but really this is about the planet. This is about us surviving. And even if we don't survive, it's about doing the most that we can to ensure that the most species survive, to kind of leave the mark that, you know, we weren't that shitty after all as a species. At the end, we kind of figured it out. And, I don't know. That's my hope anyway, right? That we'll get it together. And in the process, capitalism will disappear. Life on Earth, everybody. Thank you for being here.
Earth Day demonstrations began in practically every city and town in the United States this morning. The first massive nationwide protest against the pollution of the environment.
This planet is threatened with destruction, and we who live in it with death. The heavens reek, the waters below are foul, children die in infancy, and we in the world which is our home live on the brink of nuclear annihilation. We are in a crisis of survival.
This is a CBS News special, Earth Day, a question of survival.
The first snow, first winter of my life, I was told it was the height of me. First dance, well, the first one that counted, felt like my blood was built from crackling lights. All this ancient wildness,
Some quarters saw more than coincidence in the fact that Earth Day occurred on the 100th anniversary of the birth of Lenin, the father of Soviet communism. The Comptroller General of Georgia, James Bentley, sent out $1,600 worth of telegrams warning that Earth Day might be a communist plot.
CBS's and the NBC's of the world will be doing prime time specials on these programs, having different scientists talking about the issue.
Many people say that Sweden is just a small country and it doesn't matter what we do. But I've learned that you are never too small to make a difference. And if a few children can get headlines all over the world just by not going to school, then imagine what we could all do together if we really wanted to.
Some people say that we are not doing enough to fight climate change, but that is not true, because to not do enough, you have to do something. And the truth is, we are basically not doing anything. Yes, some people are doing more than they can, but they are too few and too far from power to make a difference today. Some people say that the climate crisis is something that we all have created. But that is just another convenient lie. Because if everyone is guilty, then no one is to blame. And someone is to blame.
This is not the love you've had before. This is something else. This is something else. This is not the same as other days. This is something else. This is something else.
Children and grandchildren are facing the gravest danger that our country has ever confronted, and it's up to us to save them from what they will have to suffer through unless we change policies. And the good news is we have all the solutions available. We can reduce pollution in the air and water at the same time. We can create tens of millions of new jobs and lower people's electric bills all at the same time. Are you with us?